Now we will tackle the question, does a vector space always have a basis? It turns out the answer is really yes, but the general case is kind of out of reach with the methods we have so far. We will focus on a particular case, which is also enough basically for everything you will need in your math 1, 2, 3, 4 lectures. Probably towards the end you might need some more, but we will see this later. So we make one more assumption and then can always get the existence of a basis, and we can get even more. Namely, we can get the following theorem. Assume V has a finite generating set. So a generating set with finitely many elements. And this set we will call E. And let A be a subset of E, which is linearly independent. So remember that a basis is something which spans the whole vector space and which is linearly independent. Here we have a big set which spans the whole space, and we have a smaller set which is linearly independent, which might just not span everything. So this is something which might have too few vectors, this is something which might have too many vectors. And the good thing that this theorem says that there is always a basis in between. Then there is a basis B of V with A subset of B subset of E. Okay, so we can always find a nice basis here in between which has those nice properties. Okay, how do we see this? So we define the following set of sets. F, so curly F, I will just use for this notation here, of FE is defined to be the set of all F subset E, such that A is a subset of F and such that F is linearly independent. Okay, so if we have a basis, it lies in this curly F of AE. So we need to study this, or we have to study this set in detail. First of all, let F1 be an arbitrary subset of curly F of AE. Note that this set is non-empty since A itself is contained in this, right? So if F is equal to A, this works. So we take an arbitrary subset in there. So if it is not a basis of V, so this is linearly independent, but if it's not a basis, so if the span of F1 is not the whole vector space, then we can just take any vector in the complement and add it to the set F1 and get a linear independent subset again by the previous lemma. It was lemma 623, so we've seen that if something does not span the whole space and we take some vector in the complement of the span, then adding this will result in another linearly independent set. So then by lemma 623, there exists some set F2, and let me just with F1 subset F2, and which is not equal. Sometimes you can also denote it like this to put this in the so a bigger subset. And this lemma says that the set is linear independent, and it contains F1, so in particular it contains A, which means that this is again in this curly F of AE. So there's a curly which is really bigger than F1 and is contained in this set. Okay, now if the span of this bigger set F2 is not V, then we can do the same thing. Then again by the lemma, we can just increase our set again. So by lemma 623, there exists a set F3 in this curly F of AE with F2 is a subset of F3, but they are non-equal. So if this happens, and so then we can do it again and again and again and again. So the question is now, does this stop? And the answer is yes, because these sets are getting bigger and bigger. But E, the set, they are all contained in all contained in E in this generating set. So this means that at some point, E is a finite set. This is a finite generating set. So if we add and add and add at least one vector with each iteration, at some point we just have to have everything, and everything spans the whole space. So we cannot, at some point we have to reach something where the span of the set is really equal to V. So this means, so defining F3, F4, and so on in F of AE iteratively by just doing this over and over again. Since E is a finite set, at some point it needs to stop. There exists some K and N with the span of Fk must eventually be the span of E, and since E is a generating set, this is V. And since Fk is linearly independent by assumption, we can just take B to be Fk has the desired properties. Okay, so we have confirmed our hypothesis. Now, one remark. Remark 626. Okay, this assumption that it has a finite generating set, as I just said, this can be dropped. So the assumption of finite generating set can be dropped. And so we can do this for any vector space and any generating set, but the general statement, so the general case requires the use of a tool from set theory, namely the famous theorem Zorn's lemma, from set theory. And this is quite complicated. This is actually equivalent to the axiom of choice, and there's some kind of lot of very theoretical discussion set theory about what can we do with Zorn's lemma and what can we avoid and what not. But this is something, this is quite too theoretical for us, so it's not really relevant for us. So we will just live with the assumption that we find a generating set which does the job here. But so just keep in mind, you can show this in this general setting, in a general setting. Okay, so before proceeding, I just want to just summarize some important corollaries of this theorem, because otherwise they might kind of remain unnoticed. So what does this have as consequences? So we have this finite generating set, linearly independent, and so on. What can we do with this? So this has several nice properties. So if we, again, assume V has a finite generating set, then we have the following consequences, which are quite obvious. So first of all, V has a basis. Okay, this is of course a trivial consequence of this, but I just want to state this explicitly. We always have a basis here. Secondly, if we have some linearly independent subset, then you can always find some, there exists a basis B of V which contains this linearly independent set. So we can complete it to a basis. And thirdly, every finite generating set contains a basis. So we can, different generating sets can lead to different bases of the vector space. Every finite generating set of V contains a basis. Okay, these are fairly obvious consequences, but there's one more which I want to discuss separately because it's kind of very commonly used. Just sort out my notes. It's a famous, this is called the basis extension theorem. So theorem 628, the basis extension theorem. So, assume again that V has a finite generating set. And that A as a subset of E be finite and linearly independent. Oops. Independent, then there exists some subset of the generating set, which I call B prime subset of E, such that B equal to, as the union of A and B prime, is a basis. So we can extend, we can extend the linearly independent set A to a basis of the whole vector space. So this is maybe not that obvious as the other consequences, but this is, since we can directly derive this from the theorem before, namely since A is finite, if we just add this to the vectors in E that we already have, A united with E, so if E is generating set, then A united with E is a finite, is a generating set. And since both sets are finite, this is again a finite generating set. It's a finite generating set. Of V. And of course, by definition, of course, it trivially holds that A is contained in this union. So this is a generating set. This is linearly independent. So by theorem 5, this directly implies that there exists a basis between these two sets. This is precisely this case that we studied. B of V with A subset B subset A united with E. And so the only thing that's left to do is to, we have to define this B prime. And this is, of course, very simple. B prime is just the complement of A and B, B without A, so all the remaining vectors. And then we've done it. So this means kind of we have some flexibility in choosing bases or starting with linearly independent subsets and creating bases from this. Okay, let me erase at this point. In the rest of the section, we will focus on properties of bases and particularly take the case of existence of finitely generating sets for vector spaces and see what properties bases of such vector spaces have. Before we do so, let's do one additional lemma, 629. This is also called the exchange lemma. Namely, we do the following. Assume we have still a vector space V, and assume that we have some basis of V and some generating set of E of V, which are not related at all so far. Then the following, if we take some vector out of B and remove it, if we take some small b of B and remove this from this basis, we can just replace it by some, I mean, these two are not related, this is important. So we can just take one element out of our basis and replace it by some suitable element of E and can always do this in such a way that we obtain a basis again. Technically, this means for all B, there exists some E in the generating set E, such that the following holds. B with small b removed and replaced by small e. So this is, as I said, so we've exchanged B and E. This is a basis of V. Okay, how can we do this? First of all, this set, notation so far, no, sorry. We take some small b in B So, first of all, this was then the characterization of a basis in terms of minimal generating sets. So by theorem 620 use this. Means if we remove anything, it's not a basis anymore, and it's not a generating set anymore. So by theorem 620, the span of B without B is not equal to V. Okay, so this is really smaller than V. So this, but then since E is a generating set of E, this means there has to be some E in the complement of this in V. So there exists some E in V without the span of B with small b removed. So this is just by properties of generating sets. We can always find something here in this complement. And we will see that this E is already enough. So if we take some E which has this property that it's in the complement of the span, then it's fine. So yeah, there exists this. And so by lemma 623, this set, I mean, this is a linearly independent set. This is a vector in the complement of some generated set there. And this means that, first of all, B without B united with E, this set I want to call B prime. And so this lemma says that this set is, again, linearly independent. Sorry, I just had to correct myself. So we know that it's linearly independent, so we need to still need to show that this spans the whole vector space, the set B prime. To do so, it now suffices to show that this contains a basis, because if some basis is included, the span of the basis, so the whole vector space is included as well. Which means if we now take this small b, which we removed and then replaced by something else, if we can show that this small b is in the span of this, this will mean that the span of all of B is in there, which means that V is in there. So to really show this generating property, it suffices to show that small b is in the span of B prime. Okay, this is what we need to show. Now, so first of all, since B is a basis, B is a basis of V, we can find that there are V1 to Vn in the complement of B, and now I'm writing this in an unnecessarily complicated way. Lambda n in K, so coefficients, and a coefficient mu in K, such that the vector E, which we added to our new system, that this is a sum from I to n, lambda I, bi, vi, plus mu times b. Okay, this is just by the basis. Every vector has such representation, and since E is any vector, we can just do this. Okay, but we have assumed that just by choice of E, E is not in the span of B without B, so E is not in span of B without small b. This means that we definitely need this vector. So we cannot have E as such a sum. So we need that this part here is non-trivial. So in other words, that mu is non-zero. And now we can do the same thing, basically almost the same trick as we did a few boards before. Because this now means that if we just move this to the other side and divide by mu, this means we get that B is equal to 1 over mu times E minus the sum I from 1 to n lambda I divided by mu times vi. And these are elements of B without small b. This is the set E, and these are all elements of B prime. So this is in span B prime, which we wanted to show. So this means that V, which is the span of everything of B, and since we've seen that B is in the span of B prime, the span of B is in the span of B prime by the properties of spans. So this means this is the whole space V, and this means B prime is a basis of V. Okay, Now, this was the first idea. So we take some bases, we throw one vector out, and can always take one extra vector in, taken from some generating set that we have given. Now, we want to take a more general statement, which is follows a similar principle, although it might look a bit different. First of all, just some notation. Given, I'm not quite sure if I introduced this notation in the beginning. If I have a finite set M, I always denote the number of elements of the set by M in absolute values. So this is just denoting the number of elements of M. Okay, just some notation. Sorry for the sudden jump. I made another mistake, so I had to correct myself. Now, theorem 630. This has a name. This is Steinitz, German mathematician, Steinitz's exchange theorem. And while the statement might not look after something is exchanged, but the proof will then turn out to be full of these exchanges. Steinitz, I think if you manage to read and pronounce the name Steinitz properly, you already mastered the first hurdle in learning German. So this has the following. So we again assume V has a finite generating set. E, so finite generating set, and we assume we have some basis of V. Let B be a basis of V, so B and E are not related at all. Then this theorem says there exists some subset of E, B prime subset of E, such that B prime is a basis of V. This is what we already know. So in the generating set, we always find a basis, but the number of elements of B prime is the same as the number of elements of B. So this shows that we can find any basis, but we have the same number of elements. In particular, this means, since B prime is just some subset of E, this means that if we have a finite generating set and we have a basis, then the basis cannot have more elements than the generating set. In particular, the basis is also finite. Okay, how do we see this? This is now basically by iterating the exchange lemma, lemma 629. Okay, so let's start with this given basis and the generating set. Let's just take some vector, some element out of our basis. Let's call this B1, just some first element. So by lemma 629, we can replace this element basically by an element of our generating set E. So in other words, there exists an E1 in E such that if we take the set which I call B1, which means we take B, remove B1, and add E1, this is a basis of V. Okay, so much this, just this, this is precisely what this lemma said. We can replace single vectors. Now we can do the same again. So take another vector, let B2 be some base vector other than B1. We can do the same again. By lemma 629, we can now find a vector E2 in E, such that, and now doing the same with B1, I call the set B2. So we take B1 and remove the vector B2 and add the vector E2 instead. And of course, just by definition of B1, this is B without the set containing B1 and B2, united with the set containing E1 and E2. So this is a basis of the vector space, a basis of V. Okay, now you see what you can do. We can do this over and over and over. So just iterating this procedure, as long as we have base vectors, iterating this procedure shows for some subset B1 to BK of our basis, where K is any natural number. So of course we cannot exceed the number of elements of B, but if we have just some finite subset here, there exists some subset consisting of K vectors as well, so E1 to EK subset of E, such that the set I call BK, which means B with the vectors B1 to BK removed, united with E1 to EK, such that this is a basis of V. Simply by applying this argument K many times. Okay, now this is crucial, and now we're actually almost done with the proof, so there's only a few more arguments left. Let me erase and I'll present them. So for each finite set removed from our basis, we find a finite subset with the same number of elements in E, such that we can replace the set of subset of B by the subset of E. So this particular is a nice consequence. Namely, we assume, and now I want to show this by contradiction, that B had more elements than E. So assume that the number of elements of B is bigger than the elements of E, and this number I will call n. So by assumption it was finite. So assume we have n elements. But this means if we do n rounds of this iteration procedure, we can kind of remove n elements from our basis. This has more than n, this is no problem. But then we have inserted every single vector of E. This means Bn would be of the form B without some subset B1 to Bn, but united with n number of n elements of E, and this is, of course, all of E. So this union here is the basis of V. But now we see that E is really a subset of this, and since B has more elements than n, so this means this has at least m plus 1 elements, this thing here, this complement here, is non-empty. So E is really a proper subset of Bn. So just by this minimizing property, Bn is a minimal generating set as a basis. This was theorem 624. This means that the span of E cannot be everything. So it's not equal to this proper subset, the span of Bn, which is V, and this is a contradiction since E is a generating set. Since E is a generating set. So we immediately obtain that the number of elements of B is smaller than or equal to the number of elements of E. Now, if I just call this number of elements of B R, and this is a finite number, this is now what we additionally knew, what we didn't know before, we can just do this procedure of exchanging R many times. So after R iterations, we obtain the set B R, where we took R vectors from our basis and added R vectors from E. So this is just a subset of E, since everything from the base has been removed. And this is a basis of V. And by the procedure, this has R elements, so the same number of elements as the basis before. And so the claim follows, if you pick up the original notation and denote this by B prime instead of BR. So this has this property. This concludes the proof of the exchange theorem. Okay, so we now know that if something has a generating set, it's every basis is finite generating set, every basis is finite. In particular, if everything, if it has a finite basis, every other basis is finite, but we can derive even more. Namely, this is now the crucial point, corollary 631. Assume V has a finite basis, name B, then every basis of V is finite. This follows already if we replace E by that basis B, so every basis is finite. And this is now crucial, the number of elements of any other basis B is the same number of elements of B for all bases B prime of V. So all bases of V have the same number of elements. This is crucial. And this is now an immediate consequence of the exchange theorem. Namely, first of all, so let B prime be an arbitrary basis. So any basis of V. So by theorem 630, then we can just take this original B as the generating set. It follows that B prime is smaller than or equal to the number of elements of B prime is smaller than or equal to the number of elements of B prime. In particular, B prime is finite. B prime is finite. So now we can just apply the theorem again with inverted roads. So with just the generating set to be equal to B prime, and then we get the reverse inequality. So applying theorem 630 with E equal to B prime, this yields the other inequality. So B, the number of elements of B is smaller than or equal to the number of elements of B prime. And so we've shown that they have the same number of elements. Okay. This is crucial, since this leads us now finally to the notion of dimension. So the number of elements of the basis is kind of does not depend on the basis, but it's just some number we can associate with the vector space, since it will have the same number for each basis. So it's irrelevant which basis we choose. This number, the sheer number of elements, this is something which is kind of belongs to the vector space and to nothing else, so we don't need any other information. And so we will, this shows that we can, that the following notion is then well defined. So definition 632, we call the vector space V finite dimensional if it has a finite basis. So if it has a finite basis, finite basis. So the number of elements of this basis, and thus by the previous result, by the corollary, for every basis, for this basis, hence every basis, of V is called the dimension. The dimension of V, and we denote this just in shorthand notation by dim V for this number. So this is the notion of dimension that you kind of have an intuitive grasp of, but this is kind of the formally correct notion of dimension. So the number of elements that you, the minimum number of elements you need to span your whole space. So it's roughly generalizing this notion of the number of coordinate axes that you have. We shall see some example. So they're just this standard example basically, but first of all, sorry, I was a bit quick and just skipped over something I wanted to mention at this point. This is the dimension, and if, so finite dimensional vector spaces, if it's a finite basis, and if V does not have a finite basis, V is called infinite dimensional. Okay, infinite dimensional vector spaces, fancy word. Anyway, Okay, so now one interesting property of finite dimensional vector spaces, which is what most of the linear algebra you will learn in now the next semester will be based on this, because it will finite dimensional vector spaces. But you will also consider infinite dimensional vector spaces. I mentioned this earlier. For example, these function spaces in quantum mechanics. So this will also be relevant for you, but let this be a worry of the future. First of all, one corollary, let V be a finite dimensional vector space and assume we have some linearly independent subset of V. Independent subset of V, then we know, and this is something I mentioned before, the number of elements of V is small, basically mentioned this before, but this can contain almost only as many elements as the dimension of V, so this number has to be smaller, and it follows that F is a basis of V, if and only if the number of elements of F is equal to the dimension of V. So if we want a basis of finite dimensional vector space, this makes it much easier, so we don't need to check the span condition. We just have to, if we know the dimension, we can just take a subset which has the right number of elements and only have to check that this is linearly independent. Then it automatically follows that this is a basis, so this spans everything. Okay, how to see this? This is actually much simpler than you might think. Namely, by the basis extension theorem, that was theorem 628, I think, there exists some, so we have some linearly independent subsets. This means we can basically extend this to a basis. There is some A subset of V with such that F united with A is a basis of V. So by the previous corollary, so that was corollary 6, 31, this means that if this is a basis, then the number of elements of F united with A needs to be the same as the dimension of V. And of course, since F is a subset of this, this implies that the number of elements of F is smaller than or equal to this and equal to this. Now, if it's a basis, if F is a basis, then since all bases have the same number of elements, it follows that this has to have dim V elements. And now, so this proves the one direction of this if and only if condition, but for the other one, so if F has dim V elements, then this union here has to be the same number as by this inequality, the number of elements of F is the same as the number of elements of F united with A, and this of course can only be the case if A is the subset of F, which means that F united with A is just F. This implies that F is a basis of V already, which shows the statement. Okay, so much about these finite dimensional things. Just one little remark and some simple example. First of all, remark, V is finite dimensional. If and only if V has a finite generating set. Okay, so if we just want to know that it's finite dimensional and don't care about the dimension or anything, it just suffices to show a finite generating set. Why is that? First of all, this direction here is obvious. since if we have a finite basis, we have a finite generating set, since the basis is a generating set. And the other implication, this basically follows from this result that every finite generating set contains a finite basis, what we've seen before, when we discussed the existence of bases. So this is follows, to be precise, from corollary 627 part C. Okay, this is what we've seen before. Okay, let me just erase one last time and then we see a few examples. Let's check the dimensions of the examples we've seen before. First of all, start with the most popular one, so to say. The dimension of k to the n as a k vector space, this is simply equal to n. This field satisfied, write this down, this is what we expect. Why is that? Since we have seen that we have a basis, since this canonical basis consisting of E1, E2, and so on to En, this is a basis which obviously has n elements. This is a basis of k to the n with n elements. Okay, so this is basically one of the most important things that we've seen so far. So we basically have the sanity check that the space R to the n is n-dimensional, also in this formalism, which shows that we really, this is a good formalism, this really extends what we would expect intuitively and what we would like to have. Okay, secondly, what is the dimension of the trivial vector space, which just contains a zero? Okay, I would now ask the audience, and the answer is zero. This is a zero-dimensional vector space, since, as we've seen, the empty set is a basis of this. It's a basis of this space only containing zero. And of course, the empty set has zero elements. Now, finally, we are ready for something infinite dimensional. For example, the dimension of the k times differentiable functions, in this case, we can now choose any k, from R to R is infinite. So why can we see this? So for all k in n zero, since it contains the set of monomials. This have we seen, this was a basis of the space of polynomials, the linear subspace of polynomials, so the set 1x, x squared, x to the 3, and so on. And this set we've seen, or I haven't shown this, but I've claimed this, which is linearly independent, and infinite. Also, the vector space of real polynomials is infinite dimensional, just because it also contains this set. And we've seen just before in the corollary that every linearly independent set of finite dimensional vector space must be finite, and so here we get the contradiction. Okay, that's it. That was everything for Mathematics 1. This is the end of the course, this is the final video. I thank you all for your attention. And if you made it this far, thank you for really keeping through. I know the first semester is probably it is kind of, at least in math and physics, the hardest part of the whole of your whole university studies. It's really hard to get a grasp, especially of the abstract mathematics, and I hope that I've found a way of kind of explaining this to you in a way that you could kind of follow. Okay, if you're still watching, then you probably could follow, but I hope that it was convenient for you to listen to my lectures and to read the lecture notes. I hope it was really helpful. I really hope to see you soon, at least in, maybe in either in YouTube videos or if I would prefer this in a real lecture hall, but of course since now I'm recording this in the February of 2020, it's still hard to say how long the pandemic will be ongoing and when there will be really full lectures and classes. I know that most of the students are eager to really return to the classroom and to really discuss the students, meet people and have open discussions and so on. I also can say that most of the teaching, almost all of the teaching staff is really would really like to go back to this mode as well. But of course, at this moment, we can't. And so I hope that this was a good replacement, that you still enjoyed doing studying at the university, except these strange circumstances. Okay, I wish you the best of health and the best for your studies so far. I hope to see you soon. Goodbye.